What's up, everybody? Kinetic here, and welcome back to Grim Dawn. I am here to share with you guys some of the things that I kind of wish I knew before I got started, or as I was getting started here in Grim Dawn, to help you guys out if you're looking to maybe buy the game, or maybe you just bought the game from Humble Bundle or something like that, and you're ready to take the dive into Grim Dawn. Well, first of all, congratulations. Grim Dawn is one of the most enjoyable ARPGs I've ever played in my life. Seriously, I've played so many different RPGs and ARPGs, and there's something about Grim Dawn. In the beginning, it may not have a whole lot of charm to it, but as you get into it, you realize that there is so much depth to the character customization. The loot hunt is extremely fun and rewarding, and the overall quality of the game is very, very well done. Combining this with what we know, of course, and that the developers are working hard to create an expansion that will hopefully come out this year, then I'm personally a big fan, and I'm really excited to continue to play and to tell other people about Grim Dawn. So what I'm doing with this video is I'm sharing 10 tips, 10 beginner tricks for you to get started, to make the most out of your character or your second character. Maybe you give up on your first character. It happens. We change our minds. We change ideas for what builds and stuff like that we want to play, don't we? Some of us have a really hard time of doing that. So what I want to do is I actually want to start with talking about what kind of build do you want to play in Grim Dawn? Now, even though this video isn't listed in any kind of particular order, I do feel like the first thing and the most important thing that you can do for yourself as far as understanding the game and where to go from the beginning is understanding what build you want to go with. Now, if you're completely new to RPGs, then this is probably going to be even more important, maybe a bit more difficult to do, as you may not have any clue, any kind of ideas on what you want to play as here in Grim Dawn. If you are relatively kind of experienced, or maybe even a pro at ARPGs, then I still recommend that you do take a look at the Grim Dawn Build Compendium, which is found on the official site. This is part of the forums section. And what you'll find here is a fantastic post here that is listing all kinds of little tidbits, including also links to tons of guides for this game. Now, these are player-made builds for all sorts of different combinations of the different classes. Here you've got Commando, Demolitionist, and Soldier combination there, and then here lists a bunch of the a bunch of the different versions of that type of build. So what we can do is we can, for example, check out here the Warborn Gunslinger Commando. It sounds pretty awesome. And it will take us to the guide. Now what you'll find here is you'll find images showing off kind of different aspects of what's going on with the build. But more importantly than that, what you also find very commonly, if not in every single one of these, is a link to GrimCalc.com. Now, what is GrimCalc.com? Basically, it is a build calculator. Now, if you're completely new to Grim Dawn, let me try and give you a really rough and dirty version of how character progression works. What you'll do is at a certain point in the game, you'll be able to choose one and then a second class to build your character around. So, for example, you may start with a soldier, which is kind of the warrior type, right? And then later on, you'll get access to adding a second class to kind of supplement your soldier's abilities and your soldier's skills, right? And so you have the system where two classes and their different traits, their different powers and things like that can be combined into something really awesome. Now, as you level, as you might expect, you can apply attribute points to just general stats in your character. For example, your physique, your cunning, and your spirit, which enhances, for example, your health and your power, magic power, stuff like that. But you'll also get points to spend here in this menu that will be inside the game. This is just a place where players can plan out their builds and make sort of recordings of how the points are being spent. So what you'll see here is the person put in 4 points into a Markovian's advantage. So this is telling me that in game, at some point, maybe sooner, maybe later, I will want to have 4 points in this stat, 4 points in fighting spirit, 12 in cadence, and stuff like that. So it's giving you a blueprint, right, of how and where you should place your points for your build and what it will generally look like once you're max level. Now, why do I go into and why do I stress the importance of understanding a build in Grim Dawn? Well, it's not as though it's that different from other ARPGs, but what I've personally felt like, what has always motivated me the most and what has kept me really pushing in every game that I play, be it D3, be it Path of Exile, or Grim Dawn, is a strong sense of a goal, something that I'm trying to reach. And when I have a build, which is really kind of my first major goal that I want to get to, I want to get to the point where I've got a really fun and smooth running build, right? I've got the pieces that I need in terms of gear, I've got my attributes set and stuff like that. That is my goal, that is my big motivator for playing RPGs and definitely playing ARPGs. So to help you, to prevent you from feeling lost or kind of directionless or something like that, that's why I start here with what kind of build do you want to play. If you can figure that out first, then that is going to be a huge motivator. That's going to be a big help in answering a lot of your questions as far as how to get started and where to go as you're playing the game. Alright, so that first tip was quite loaded and long-winded, and I promise you the rest of these will go much faster than that, but like I said, knowing your build I think is extremely important. Next up, I'm going to talk about items and what to do with them. You're going to find all kinds of stuff here. You're going to find, of course, gear. For example, here we've got a yellow axe, right? This is a magic two-hand axe. The green shield that I have here, this is a rare shield, and then over here, for example, I've got some epic blue boots. You're gonna find lots of stuff like this, of course, because it's an ARPG, that's what we do, we hunt for loot, right? But you're also gonna find something called components, and you're gonna find partial components as well. Components are basically mods that you can add to your gear. For example, here on my pistol, I've got, you can see down kind of about halfway, it says Devil Touched Ammo. That is a component mod that I describe it as, that I've added to the gun that gives me more power to that item. And you've got lots of components for different types of gear, also armor pieces. You can see there it says Hollowed Ground. That's a rare component mod that I've added. Now, sometimes you'll find these in just a single form, and then other times you'll find them in partial forms. So here with the chipped claw, you can see it says partial component 1 of 3. So I'll need to combine 3 chipped claws to make a full chipped claw component. So all of this is extremely important, and I mean everything that you see here, all of this is really important to pick up and to hoard for some reason or another. Is no matter how many of these chip claws you find, trust me, they are probably going to be important at some point or another, because not only can you use these components to mod your gear, but you can also use them to craft other mods and other important things here in the game. So collect all of these, okay, every single one of these components, and put them in your stash, and I'll show you guys that later. Also, you're gonna want to probably pick up all of the yellow pieces, or at least as many yellow and up rarity items, I think, as you can find, especially during the early course of the game. The reason why I say that is because even though probably all of these, actually, most definitely, all of these yellows are not useful to my character and to my build as far as equipping them, what I would want to do, definitely, is to put these in my inventory as I'm out there hunting and then come over here and sell them to a merchant. This is important because going back and talking about crafting, things like that, or maybe even purchasing items from different merchants, you're gonna need a lot of money. Like, I just recently had almost 300,000 or something like that, and then for whatever reason, I guess the items that I was buying and some of the crafting that I was doing, you can see now I'm less than 100k, which is crazy. So trust me when I say you're gonna want to pick up and you're going to want to deliver as many items as you can to a vendor to make sure that you've got a nice sizable pool of currency for all sorts of different things here in the game, from crafting items yourself or just buying them outright from different vendors. Now, here's another little tip. as far as filtering your loot. There's a little button down here that is almost impossible to see unless somebody points it out to you. This little button is really, really useful and just kind of helping to make sure that your screen is a little bit cleaner than it would be by default. Now, what this does is it filters out showing you certain rarities of items and only showing you what you've selected here for the option and above. So for example, if I want to not see, for whatever reason, I don't want to see yellow magic items that drop from monsters or that drop from treasure chests or something like that, I can have it set to only show me rare and above. So here we have a magic metal, I can drop it on the ground, and it's completely invisible. If there are like dozens of these, and there will be, of these items falling all over the ground, then and I don't want them, then I can simply hide them like that and it makes for a cleaner looking screen. Now you can have this set to common and up, and now you can see there is the stalwart star again. What I've got it set for myself is I've got it set to magic and up, because like I said, I'm picking up all of these yellows, selling them for money here on the vendors. Alright, let's take a moment to kind of look into and expand just a little bit on the first 2 points regarding loot and stuff like that. You will get access to a smuggler-like character who is basically your stash. You'll find these guys in different towns, and this is where I hoard all of my components that I'm collecting. And I can hold down shift and left click to add these into the stash area. Potions as well, gear as well if I want to, and there's also some really useful buttons that you'll see in the inventory spaces. This one will combine or complete your components. With a simple click like that, it auto combines all of your partial components into as many as it can into making a complete component. And then this would be your auto sort button here, which will click and create a listing of your items in alphabetical order. Also, at some point in the game, not too deep into it, you'll get access to a character called the Spirit Guide. Now, this person will allow you to reallocate your spent character points in your different classes. So, for example, here with my Demolitionist, if I want to refund points that I've spent, for example, maybe in Flame Touched or something like that, then I can do that here, and of course, it will cost Iron Bits, the currency that you use here in Grimdawn. Now we'll get into the devotion system a little bit later, but let's just say this is a much more difficult and expensive kind of point system that is a big expansion for your character's class and your progression. You spend points here that gives you more attributes and more abilities, but refunding these is not nearly as easy. So be warned that especially if you don't know what build that you're getting into, maybe you're just going in this game completely blind or as blind as possible, please know that the devotion point system is serious business, and so just, you know, throwing points together here is going to be detrimental probably to your long-term goals maybe that you might develop in your character's progression. So again, this is part of why I stress that knowing your build and knowing maybe how you want to set up your devotion points early on, before you really get in deep with your character, is really, really important. Alright, it's time we get the hell out of this dusty town and go explore. One little tip I want to share with you before we actually start running around and killing things is that you've got also another very small and well-hidden button here that will help you toggle different quick slot bars. Oh, hello there, Mr. Weevil. How are you today? And by clicking on this button, it will allow you to select different quick slot bars. And what I've done is I've set up my buffs here on my second quick slot bar. So I've got Vindictive Flame. I've got another ability on number 2, 3, and the 4 keys. And so now all my buffs are set up, and this allows me to have more space here on my main quick slot bar where I have all of my active offensive and defensive abilities. That is something that nobody told me about, and I basically didn't figure out until much, much later on. So exploration is important, duh, of course it is, Kinetic. Yes, but exploring everything even, is extremely important here in Grimdawn. In other ARPGs, which I will not name, exploration may not be as important. Clicking on everything may not be as important because most containers may contain next to nothing useful, but it is not the case here in Grimdawn. You will find all sorts of fun and exciting things here in Grimdawn. You're going to find treasure chests that actually open up and give you some cool loot inside. You're going to also find pieces of paper that will actually give you experience for reading them, and as well as, of course, tell an interesting story and expand on the lore of what's going on in the game. Yes, reading lore helps you level up. Don't forget that. And there's another little tip for you thrown in here. You'll find a treasure chest, you'll find lore pages. You're going to find secret entrances to dungeons that are not marked on the map. You may have an idea of what I am going to point out as an example of that here. If you've played Grimdawn, there is a cave entrance around here that is hidden, that you cannot see on the main map. Almost all other dungeons in this game will come with like a little highlight that it will show on the map for you, pointing out that hey, there's an entrance to a cave, or there's an entrance to a fort or something like that, you know, with a dungeon that you can explore over here. But there are caves, there are secret caves, there are secret passageways that will lead to expanding areas that you cannot see on the map. And there it is, there is the entrance to the Hive, a pretty wicked area inside where you can fight a bunch of similar monsters like these. Oh, look, there's a boss. That star above that guy's head means that he's a badass, and you will want to kill him if you want cool loot. And he is dead already. I'm kind of over-leveled for this area, but here you can see this is an example of all of the loot that is splashing on the ground that is only magic yellow tier and up, and I definitely want to collect that. I've also found a rare component as well. That's cool. What's this? Ooh, lucky day. Holy crap. I don't believe it. I've actually been looking for this. This is a blueprint relic Marauder's Talisman. I can't believe I found that while recording this. That is absolutely awesome. I can't wait to make that. This right here is a vital essence, and this will restore your constitution. You may have noticed, maybe you didn't, as you are out of combat and you've taken damage, I'm just gonna let these guys beat me up a little bit first. Okay, can you see that my health is going down? Now if I'm out of combat, look at that, my health will refill, but I'll also lose that kind of yellow layer, a bit of that yellow layer above it, or over it, in the process. That's your constitution, and is basically almost like a second health bar, sort of, that will refill your health. And once you're out of that, well, then you're SOL, right? But picking up things like vital essence, there'll also be food rations and things like that that you can pick up that will help to refill and restore your constitution. Now, I'm pretty anxious to get back to town and use this new recipe that I've got, but rather instead of running back to a normal rift, which is basically a portal that allows players to travel around the world of Grimdawn, I can actually create my own rift, which is really, really handy for a number of reasons. Of course, this will allow you to, on the spot, create a portal that will take you back to town if you want to sell gear, if you want to use recipes, whatever your reason for wanting to travel around, you can create a rift portal anytime you want. But even better than that is in the way that they can create shortcuts in case you are getting into something that might be over your head. For example, let's say you're about to jump into a dungeon, or maybe you're in a dungeon and you think you might have a chance of dying. What you can do is you can go ahead and set up a rift portal of your own, a personal rift, either just outside of the dungeon, or in most cases you can create a rift inside of the dungeon. So in case you are running around the dungeon and you die, rather than respawning from town and then taking the town portal to the world rift portal, which then would mean you have to probably run from that portal all the way back to the dungeon, all the way back to where your body was, you will just instead be able to access your personal rift now instead when you revive in town from the town rift gate. So it's a much faster way of recovering your lost time and getting back into the action. instead of having that long walk of shame that you'll probably experience. I've had that walk of shame definitely myself. I've forgotten to create my own rift portals, but that is a really good tip right there, and something that I know for a fact that I've read a few times within my my YouTube videos. There it is, there's the Marauder's Talisman. Now, what this does is it's actually going to do the same thing as the Marauder's ammo belt here, and that it's going to give me the ability to dual wield pistols, which is really important for my build. Now, the reason why I want to craft this so bad right now is because I really want to upgrade this belt. I'm level 50 and I'm still wearing a level 26 belt, which it's not so much as it's the level difference, it's just that I'm really confident that I can find something better that will be a higher level. So I want to replace this belt and get something better in there, while still, of course, keeping the ability to dual wield pistols. And it looks like I have an attribute point to spend here. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to put it into cunning. Here we go. I've also got points to spend in my demolitionist or arcanist trees. I think I am, yeah, I'm gonna spend a couple of points. There we go, there's the one left that I needed to access elemental balance. As you spend points here, you expand your mastery of a class, giving you access to more and extremely powerful abilities in the mastery of this class. So now that I've spent that many points up to this point here, I can go ahead and access elemental balance, and I'm going to spend the other 2 points to get that. Now, I believe this is a passive ability. Some of these are active and some of these are passive. For example, here is Alexra's Flash Freeze. This is an active ability that I click on to freeze enemies as an offensive and very defensive ability for my character. Alright, so it seems I incidentally combined tips 3 and 4 into one speech, and that was tip 3, explore everywhere, and tip 4 was reading the notes, or at least picking them up and clicking on them, so that way you get the experience from reading those lore notes. You may not care about lore, but I guarantee every RPG player cares about experience, so pick up those notes and click on them. Alright, so now, tip 5. This is kind of a weird one, but it's something that kind of blew my mind as I was playing Grimdawn. About day 3 or day 4, for whatever reason, I waited until then to check my video settings, and then I realized that my graphical settings weren't set to what they should be according to the power of my graphics card. Now, in this case, I have a really good graphics card in my PC, and it wasn't maxing out the graphical settings the way that I thought that it should. And then I went in and I started adding more anti-aliasing, better shadows, weather, etc., etc., and the game looked so much better. I couldn't believe it. So if you're playing the game and you haven't checked your graphical settings and you're wondering why your game doesn't look as good as mine or something like that, that's probably why. So it's just a little thing, but I think it really makes a big difference. It did for me anyway. As soon as I cranked up those settings, man, oh my god, the game looks so good. And as you can see here, this is how amazing I think Grimdawn can look. Look at the amount of detail here, the trees moving, the shadows, weather effects, and lighting. It looks absolutely fantastic. All right, we're back in Devil's Crossing because there's another really important thing that I want to talk about when it comes to components. I did forget to mention that some components, they not only mod your gear to give you more power. For example, here the Mark of the Traveler gives me plus health regen, gives me movement speed, gives me slow resistance, things like that. Some of these mods will actually grant you new passive or even active abilities. For example, the Devil Touched Ammo, which I believe I pointed out earlier, gives me a granted skill, Demon's Breath. Now, this is an active offensive skill that I can use and is what I have here set to number 2, and is one of, if not my most powerful ability that I have in my build. So that's another reason why collecting and hoarding those components is so important. But there's something else about components. What do you do when you are upgrading your items but you still want that component back? Well, at some point not too far into the game, you'll get access to Darlit. And what you can do with her is you can take your your old items that you no longer need. Now, these are old shoulder pads, for example, that have some bristly fur. Not the greatest component, but I still want it back. Now, you've got two options here. You've got salvage and you've got dismantle. In this case, the difference between salvage and dismantle is that one will simply give you the option to either keep the item, which would be the shoulders here, or keep the add-on. So if I have no interest whatsoever in keeping the shoulder piece, I just want the component back, then I will click on keep add-on. This will spend 681 iron bits. It gives you a warning, are you sure you want to do this? It will destroy the item, give you the augment. Yes. So there we go. There's my bristly fur back. Now, the difference with that and dismantling is that what it will basically do is it will give you back both of the items. So here with the Swamp Dweller's leg guards, I can put these here. And what this will do is it will cost, for some strange reason, dynamite. Yes, dynamite. You use dynamite to salvage gear here in Grim Dawn, which, as you can tell, still makes me laugh. I think it's really goofy. But this is a resource that you can find. It's kind of rare, but if you know the right places, you can farm to get more dynamite when needed. This will allow me to dismantle any item with or without components and break down and give me what it's made of, more or less. So click dismantle. It's going to give me another warning. And bam. So what I got was 4 pieces of scrap, and I got my ancient armor plate component that I had added on there. If you don't have a component, it will give you still a component, which is actually quite amazing. There's no component here on the injector, but I'll dismantle it and it still gives me a component. So this is a way actually that if you are willing to farm a lot of dynamite and you're looking maybe for some rare components or something like that, this might be a good way of going about getting those items. But for the most part, I don't bother with that, especially if I'm just trying to get my my components back. I'll click and use this option to get back my my add-ons. All right, so that was tip 6. Look for and combine, recycle your components back from old gear. Number 7 is going to be take some time out to do bounties. Once you reach a certain reputation with one of the different factions, and there are many factions, then you will have access to doing bounty missions. You can approach a bounty table, and this is basically like a side quest. It will give you more than likely a kill quest, but not in the kind of repetitive go kill 100 or something, you know, I don't know, lizard guys or something like that. It will usually give you a boss hunting kind of kill quest, which is usually exciting still, even if you're going to a lower level area, because the boss that you're hunting will be leveled up and appropriate to your level, so it will still give you a good challenge, and the loot that he drops will still be relevant to your level as well. Now, why are bounties and factions so important? Well, you have quartermasters that give you unique items that you can only get from them, and some of these factions give you extremely useful and powerful new gear that you can buy straight from them, and also different things like, for example, augments. Now, augments is kind of like sort of a similar concept to components. So the importance of factions is getting your reputation up by doing bounties, and you don't have to do just bounties. You can also you can kind of repeat dungeons in certain areas where that faction has influence, and then you'll gain reputation that way. But the bounties are a great way, like I said, to build up your reputation, to farm or hunt down bosses and maybe farm up some gear. And so here I've got access with the honored level of reputation. I've got access to some epic medals, some epic rings, and also some really powerful magic augments that I can add to my gear. Alright, tip number 8. Let's kind of expand and talk again about devotion points. Devotion points come from shrines. You'll find shrines while exploring out in the open. Sometimes you'll find them in the most difficult parts of dungeons. And by approaching these shrines and fulfilling their requirements, you will get devotion points. Now, sometimes the requirement is that they want you to spend certain components, kind of, I don't know, donate those components to the shrine, and then you'll get the devotion points in return. Sometimes you also maybe even get a decent piece of gear. But most of the time, you'll just find vendor trash in my experience. Sometimes the challenge is actually to fight a couple of waves of enemies. Usually, this is not very difficult, if difficult at all. So don't worry too much about what you're about to face. Just get over there, activate that shrine, and get yourself some devotion points. Now, what they've also done is they've made it easy to keep track of all of the shrines that you have cleared, and also keep track of shrines that you haven't. As you can see here, these markers here, that's a restored shrine there, restored shrine, restored shrine, restored shrine. Now this is the shrine icon with a check mark, meaning that it is restored, if I had found a shrine, but I didn't, for example, maybe have the component that I needed to restore the shrine, that would still have a marker here on the map, but instead of a check mark, I believe it's a red X. So it still gives you a marker on your map, so that way you can have a general idea of where you need to be. For example, Shaded Basin, if I hadn't restored the shrine, then I go back to maybe Devil's Crossing or something like that to get the component, and then I know to come back here to the Shaded Basement to find that shrine. Tip number 9 is kind of similar to tip number 1, but in its own way. Tip number 1 was talking about how, of course, there are guides to show you what kind of builds you can put together here, and the importance of builds and having a goal in Grimdawn, right? Well, tip number 9 is just a reminder that there are guides for everything related to Grimdawn, probably in the form of maybe a written post on the forums or maybe a video here on YouTube. If you're looking for certain dungeons that you can use to farm gear at your level, if you're looking for certain locations maybe where you need to find components or recipes, or what faction, you know, offers what good weapons and items and things like that for your build, there are so many good written guides out there, wikis and stuff like that. So keep that in mind. Remember that there's a lot of really good information out there, Grimcalc, the official forums, and YouTube to help you out. Or even if you like trading, you can totally trade legendary items here in the game, both in normal and in the hardcore modes. And guess where you'll find that? On the forums. The forums is a great place to connect with other players and to even do trading with them if you're looking for something to trade once you do get kind of to max level. If you're looking for certain legendaries or even epics, whatever, then you will find players on the forums that are willing to trade with you if you've got the right stuff. And number 10, my last piece of advice for you is relax and enjoy the game. Grimdawn is not something that you need to rush through, to hurry up and get to max level and get to end game like other ARPGs out there, like Diablo, like Path of Exile. This is a much more laid back kind of experience, I think. And unless you've got some buddy that's being a dick and pressuring you into hurrying up and getting to his level, there's no need to rush. And that's gonna wrap it up for my beginner's tips and tricks for new Grimdawn players. This is by far, I think, one of the most underrated but enjoyable ARPG experiences that I've had in recent years, and is the perfect alternative. Like I said, I use that term a lot, perfect alternative to Path of Exile, to Diablo 3. If you're looking for something that is more laid back and less kind of pressuring you into hurrying up and getting to endgame, if you're looking for a more single player kind of experience, if you like self-found gameplay, stuff like that. Anyway, like I said, that's gonna wrap it up for this video. We've got an expansion pack coming up for Grimdawn, hopefully not too long from now, and I am very excited for that. You can expect to see videos of that here on my channel, but until then, let me know what your thoughts are down in the comment section below. Click the like button to support Grimdawn here on the channel, and make sure you're subscribed so you don't miss the next video. Thanks again for watching. This is Kinetic, and I'll see you next time.